Excited, ready?
Ready, excited.
Ready, but not excited. We're going to call the work session of Tuesday, August the 9th, 2011, to order. The next item on the agenda is citizen comments for issues that are not on the agenda. Does anyone want to address the board in the work session? I see none. We'll move on to status update on Clovercroft School and related infrastructure.
Mr. Mayor, as we were putting this agenda together, it occurred to us that about a year ago, we were working through a lot of issues to make, and work with the Williamson County Schools system and to make any adjustments we could to help the school project move forward, and went through a lot, both related to the school project itself and related infrastructure. And thought it would be good, with school starting in a couple days, to give you just an overview of where we are, on that project, and where that those issues are, just so that you know as we move forward. The school is ready to open. A number of us were there on Sunday afternoon for the open house and for the ribbon cutting, and we're pleased to see that moving forward. A lot of the infrastructure improvements that were anticipated have been made, but the signals are not in place yet. And that is a process that is still ongoing. The clearance has been given from TDOT. The contractor is released, but that work is not complete yet. In the meantime, Williamson County Schools has agreed to provide both police officers and sheriff's deputies, depending on the intersection, to help with that so that things can function at load in and load out on the school days. So but we are also doing planning to help move forward with the elements that are our responsibility, and wanted to just sort of give you a brief overview, take a couple minutes and talk about that, some of which we've talked about around this table in the last few months, but thought it might be helpful to just review that and let Vernon and Eric talk about some specifics. Vernon's had some contact with the schools about where we are with the signals and those issues as well. So.
Thank you, and good evening. Eric's correct. The school had a ribbon cutting Sunday afternoon, very well attended by many of the families and children, and for those of you there, it was a good celebration. But part of the agreement in working with the city, between the city and Williamson County Schools, was that the traffic signals would be operational by the first day of school. And while we and the schools have been working diligently, they're not going to be installed. But the school district is hiring some police officers to manage and supervise those two intersections in the morning and afternoon, both at Wilson Pike and McEwen Drive, as well as Wilson Pike and Clovercroft, where the signals are going to be installed. S&W Contracting is the contractor that's working for the school district to put those signals in, and they have every expectation that they'll complete the improvements, some curbing, minor paving at those intersections, as well as installing the traffic signals within the 60 days that their contract is to complete that work. I spoke to a representative from that company yesterday, and they hope to have people out on site starting some of that work next week. And also, after the traffic signals, but over in the next year or so, we're going to be making some improvements to the intersection at McEwen Drive and Wilson Pike, and I wanted Eric to provide you a brief update on that and where we're going.
We had a resolution a few months ago that the board approved that allowed additional funding for the intersection of McEwen and Wilson. And so we've moved forward with, we've given our designer direction to move forward with the option that was associated with that. And they're in the process of designing the bridge right now. And we've gone through the permitting process with CSX. And so we're going through all those processes that we had talked about last year as far as the things that would be required to get this intersection improved. And so, while it did push our schedule a few months, getting approval of funding for the option that we're going with, we still should be on schedule to the term from the agreement is to have the money committed by next October, and we're still on schedule for that.
you'll remember the design that we selected was one that would minimize the amount of rework we have to do when we extend and make the improvements on McEwen up to Wilson. So what we've lots of times referred to as McEwen 4. We talked about doing this so in a way that minimizes the amount of rework and is consistent with that and helps bring the improvements, but also be an efficient use of our dollars. So we're spending maybe a little more than we might have anticipated on the front end so that we don't have to redo it and spend more long term. So that's the direction you all have given us and that we're moving forward with. But wanted to just give you this overview of the elements as they're coming together a year later. And, you know, a lot has happened in a year, and a pretty substantial school is now in place and is ready to open and operate in a couple days.
Do you want to ask Alderman Peterson?
A couple of things. Our agreement was just that the money would be committed by that certain date. I was under the impression that we had committed to have it spent.
Well,
by that time, which I took to mean that it was going to be constructed, but
we'll get as far as we can. It does need to be committed by then because of it's bond funds that the county has issued. So as long as we've obligated it by that time period. Now, I think our vision is to have it awarded well before that. Now, where we are in the work on that will, whether it's complete by that time frame, I don't know that the project will be complete, but it'll be well underway and funds committed, which is really what the test we need to meet in terms of the use of those bond funds.
It won't be completed. It was something that, even if we would, I think we even talked about this a year ago, if we would have started construction, you know, last year at this time, we would have been lucky to have gotten construction completed by October because, I mean, when you're talking about bridge, construction and then we talked about the elements of working with CSX and TDOT and I mean just doing design and purchasing right away. I think a year ago the schedule that we came up with was that we would be able to bid it out roughly May of next year. And as I said, with a few months of going through the funding and the options, that still leaves us a little bit of time, a little bit before the October deadline, which was, as Eric said, committed, and we've discussed that committed would be that it would be bid and awarded to a contractor.
Does the county agree with that because it's their bond?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. On part of it. Mm-hmm. We do have mm-hmm. enough money from that special fee to mm-hmm. pay our part.
Yes. Yes.
But still, has the county agreed?
That was part of when we negotiated the agreement. That was part of the understanding.
But the county has agreed then that mm-hmm. we just have to have it.
You need to just have it obligated or committed at that point to the project.
Okay. But boy, they're going to be more than a year where, you know, they're going to be in. I would think that it would be on the fast track with us.
And it is. There's just complexity with dealing with the right-of-way and the railroad and designing and doing a bridge of this magnitude. So there's a good deal of complexity to it, but we're on track to get it obligated well before October.
When I saw that they had put that building up mm-hmm. in that space of time, mm-hmm. and as far as I know, we've just done the design, we've started on the design, kind of concerned me since they got it built.
We're about where we expected to be
okay.
a year ago.
Okay.
Go ahead, Alderman.
I'm probably in the minority, but when you mentioned hiring policemen and hiring deputy sheriffs, that's just swapping taxpayer money. The school system didn't really do anything to stop the traffic signal or anything else. My personal opinion is it's that we furnish the policeman that's needed. That's part of our obligation is in the city limits, furnish the policeman. I don't see any reason personally to build the school system, and I'm going to pay the taxes to go to the school system to come back to pay the taxes that's going to pay the policeman unless there's something there that I am missing along the way. I think it's our obligation to furnish whatever we need to furnish for that intersection if it's not something that was caused by those that are requesting that service.
Well, I think where the schools are coming from is it was their obligation per the agreement to deliver the signal. Mm-hmm. So since the signal isn't there, they're going to make sure that there's some other controls in place through officers to take care of traffic. So I don't know it's so much about the bill as it is the responsibility per the agreement, which was to get a signal in place.
And I think it's our responsibility to signal, to control the traffic at that intersection.
We will.
And they will need it based on...
There'll be lots of folks there, that's for sure.
Actually, the intersection over by Clovercroft, yeah, and McEwen, or Clovercroft and Wilson Pike.
As a county.
As a county, and they had anticipated hiring sheriff's deputies to monitor that intersection and manage it during those two times during the day, but they were having trouble as of this morning locating some long-term commitments for that. So I do believe they contacted Chief Rohinski to ask if some of our officers could help out with that intersection as well.
We're working together to cover this.
Alderman Berger?
Is there any way, I know we're trying to move this ahead as fast as possible, and it would be so helpful to have those funds. And I know, first of all, let me backtrack. Let me ask you, who's helping us with CSX Railroad?
Our staff, along with our engineering firm.
You know how that's been in the past. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that can delay. So are we getting any help with that outside the city?
Yes. We have our engineering staff as well as the designer working on that as well. And we do have a contact at CSX that came up on another issue that we can explore as well.
We've got somebody, one person like we're communicating with on that, because sometimes if you communicate with them, then we have multiple people, and that just doesn't work out. We know how that went with that Mallory Station signal. The other thing is... I know we're trying to rush this ahead and do as much as we can, but it would be so helpful to be able to start the construction when school's out in the summer.
Well, we're looking to award the bid mid-year next year. So that would be May, June, July, so that would potentially hit that, but we'll get it out as quickly as we can.
I know, but I'm just saying, I think anything we can do, and I know we are.
The construction period is long enough. You're not going to avoid interference with school. You're going to have to plan for that and construct around it.
The schedule that we set was based off of estimates on. It wasn't set to be under construction at a certain time. It was based off of what was expected. How long it was going to take to design it? How long it was take to acquire the right of way? How long it was going to take to deal with all the. The entities that are involved, CSX and TDOT. Yeah. Of course, if we can get it done quicker, yes. We're not. It's not based on a time we're going to.
Okay.
We're going to do it or whatever.
The other thing is, how much right of way do we have to get yet?
We won't know till the design's complete, which they started on it.
When do we think we're going to get the design complete? Do you have any?
Timetable
on
then
that?
It kind of then ties to CSX. They've got it right now. The permit that they're working on is to be able to get permission from CSX to go out there to do borings, to do additional survey. So it's one of the steps. But I believe the original estimate was we were going to have something either late April or early May. So if we were delayed about 3 or 4 months with the options, that puts us later September, October, I think.
Okay. Ready to move on?
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Next, we'll have a presentation on water treatment / distribution update of the Integrated Water Resource Plan. So
we'll invite our team up from CDM.
CDM team?
Yeah, this is the next installment in your mini-series related to the Integrated Water Resource Plan.
Remember last time whenever you were here, I asked you to send us your presentation. Mm-hmm. I do not believe I got that.
Okay,
so if you
we'll make sure. It should be on the website.
But I want it to
Yes, ma'am. We will make sure. In fact, we've got it on a flash drive here with us tonight that we can get it to you before we leave, if you'd like.
I brought it back from Dory.
As I say, I just want it coming to me.
We'll definitely do that.
Last one and this one.
The last one and this one tomorrow to all of y'all. So
great. Have at it.
All right.
Welcome.
Well, thanks again. As we mentioned last month, we sort of have four installments, which were broken up into different pieces, even though ultimately, in the last group, we're going to talk about how some of these things work together, and a little bit tonight we will as well, when it comes to some water supply issues, just sort of throwing out some ideas that have come out of this process and that are being discussed. But tonight, we're primarily going to talk about the water treatment plant and water distribution. This is a slide y'all have seen before, but as you see, as we have circled there toward the bottom, last month we sort of covered stormwater, water conservation, ecological restoration, and tonight we're going to cover a little bit on water treatment, on the water treatment plant itself and on the water distribution system. So, and then later this month on the 23rd, we're going to have a longer session to talk a little bit about wastewater and biosolids. So, with a wrap-up meeting on the 13th, where we'll sort of start showing some of the water quality models, some of the Stella modeling, and how some of these things start interacting and what, you know, is starting to be some of the results of some of those analysis prior to our next BOMA meeting. I mean, our next stakeholder meeting, excuse me. So tonight, as I mentioned, we sort of want to cover first a little bit on water demand and supply, then touch on a little bit some of the upon us regulatory requirements that are some of the drivers associated with your system at this point and how they can affect some of the decisions that may be made on the water treatment plant and water distribution system over the next year to 2 years. A little bit on the water treatment plant itself, reviewing some of the past analysis that was done by CTE on some of the water treatment plant expansion, updating some of those costs, updating some of the treatment capacities as well, and look at the water distribution system as well. So we'll start a little bit with water demand and supply. Just so everyone is on the same page, especially for people that may be watching at home or people in the crowd that may not be aware, and, you know, the city of Franklin is not, although the city serves a large portion of the city, it does not totally serve the entire population of the city of Franklin. As you can see from the graphic, there are actually four water purveyors within the city of Franklin, three of which buy totally from Harpeth Valley Utility Districts, HB&TS, Mallory Valley, and Millcroft, and then of course yourselves, which have a water treatment plant which currently produces about 2.1 million gallons a day, as well as also buy water from Harpeth Valley Utility District. So that just sort of shows a breakdown of the sea limits and where sort of the service area is. As we'll touch on in just a second, when we look at the demands in regards to the city of Franklin system itself, you're getting relatively close to build out. In fact, over the next 30 years, you'll basically reach that point, and we'll have a graphic of that in a second.
How many years did you say?
Well, this plan sort of looks through 2040, and as you'll see on this graph here, which shows the average daily demand, the maximum day demand, and the minimum daily demand, you'll see that line is pretty flat. I mean, basically a less than 2 million gallon a day growth over the next 30 years, which will basically bring the city's service area, based on the current boundaries of the service area itself, to pretty much build out. There's still obviously some opportunities for a little bit of infill, redevelopment, et cetera, through some of the areas within the city itself. However, it's not anything that's going to have a major impact on the overall capacity of the system. So in general, as you can see, the average daily demand now, you're at about, right now you're at an average daily demand of about a little over 6 MGD, with that growth in the next 30 years being about a little over 8 MGD, so about 2 million gallons a day. So, go ahead. This next graphic just sort of gives you an idea of where the city gets its water from. As I mentioned previously, as you're aware, you have your own water treatment plant that has a capacity of about 2.1. As you can see, this is a monthly volume number. So as you can see, in general, that red line has stayed fairly constant, obviously, since the late 70s, as the plant has always stayed at that similar capacity. Starting in about 78, you began to supplement that water supply with the need by buying water from Harpeth Valley. And as you can see, over the years, that has continued to grow. Now, over the last couple of years, since the droughts of 07, that's come back down a little bit. But in general, you know, basically you have a flat line on the treatment capacity that you have, and everything else is supplemented by Harpeth Valley itself. That's a really key important piece to remember as we start talking a little bit more about the water treatment plant and particularly the water distribution system. There's a lot of things that we'll talk about tonight that are going to be important over the next couple of years. And it's always key to remember that although you can do some things at your own water treatment plant, you always have to also take into account that a large portion, particularly in the summer, you know, 60, you know, two-thirds to 75% of your water is coming from someone else that you don't necessarily have that control of all the time. This is real quick because it ties into a little bit what we're going to talk about here in regards to water supply. This sort of graphic real quickly that shows sort of from a river perspective where the existing water treatment plant is off of Lewisburg Pike and where the existing wastewater treatment plant is sort of behind Franklin High School. And in regards to the potential wastewater treatment plant site that was purchased by the city a couple years ago. Obviously, that's a big piece of the overall integration and how these things tie together, whether or not the existing plant can be expanded, as we've discussed before. Can the total capacity be expanded at that site? Do you need another site? This is just one piece we want to show of how these things work together and how it does make a little bit a big portion of the of what we feel like the decision when it comes to if you end up expanding your existing wastewater treatment plant or not, based on where that wastewater capacity is. And I say that because as you see this graphic here, basically there's in any time, you know, when you're limited in your capacity, you're always looking at ways to decrease demand. We talked about water conservation a little bit last month, and also at the same time increase supply. And we all know the supply opportunities within the Harpeth are very limited. Your current ARAP permit only allows you to take no more than 20% of the total daily flow within the river, or if it's less than 10 CFS, you can't withdraw at all. What this graphic sort of represents is the solid lines, which would be in blue, a 2 million gallon a day plant with no wastewater treatment plant built south of the city. So this would be in with the decision that all wastewater treatment plant capacities would stay either at that existing site in one shape, form, or fashion in some sort of upgrade, so you would actually have no treatment south of the city as was the reason for the purchase of the property a couple years ago. The green solid line, I mean the green dotted line being a plant at 4 million gallons a day with no wastewater treatment plant south of the city. The solid lines are then what the potential could be at the plants if you were to have a wastewater treatment plant discharge south of the city. Now, you know, this plant would be approximately 3 miles upstream, and you know, although this is it happens all over the place where, you know, you have cities upstream that discharge in directly adjacent to where the next city down may take out their water treatment plant water. This is sort of a new concept generally throughout the United States. It's not exactly in direct potable reuse, but you know, you're putting it back in the river and almost directly taking it back out. What this does show is that it adds a large amount of capacity at your plant that you wouldn't have because of the restrictions on the Harpeth, particularly during the summer. That additional base flow that could come from a high level effluent from the wastewater treatment plant could provide an additional ability to withdraw in the summer months when otherwise you're having to supplement that in the Harpeth Valley. That's just, you know, one graphic that we want to show. You know, another key factor here is what you can see, even with an expanded 4 million gallon a day water treatment plant, if you don't have any additional, take into account, this doesn't account at all any fluctuation in the reservoir. So you do have some play with that, although at 4 million gallons, you have less than 30 days, and that would put you, based on the drought management plan, into some sort of drought occurrence. But what it shows is, you know, if you start looking at expanding the water treatment plant without some additional source, you know, down, you know, upstream from where the existing water treatment plant is, even in the summer, you're still going to be very, very limited in what your treatment capacity would be because of the low flow within the river.
So let me ask this then. If you've got a treatment plant
right
that's south, that's putting the water in, that's flowing down to the water treatment plant, what is the difference then if you take the water out of the treatment plant that is existing and pump it above your current water treatment plant? What is the philosophical difference?
I don't know if there really is a philosophical difference, and
there's actually a permit difference. The existing plant is permitted to discharge at the location where it currently is, and so moving that discharge would probably be as difficult as obtaining a new permit.
Yeah, I mean, one thing I throw out all the time,
would it be $60 million difficult?
that's an analysis we'd have to run.
What about reclaimed water?
That's something I talk about all the time, Mike. You know, it's something that it'd be interesting to really get down into the yeah. states, is to actually take some of the reclaim, you know, reclaim, although the sources of use in the summer are really high. So that amount of reclaimed water is not as available during the summer months, but, you know, definitively during the winter months, you know, what's the difference of discharging directly into any other reclaim and pumping it right back to your reservoir? But, you know, there is definitely some, you know, regulatory hindrances to some of those things, so. Any questions?
All right. Well, the obvious is, though, nobody around here much does getting your drinking water after the wastewater's been.
We're doing it constantly right now.
Well, but wait, let me say to you, though, there's really not a lot south of us that's.
No. We're located right now with Harpeth Valley below the Nashville-Davidson right. County wastewater treatment plant. That's so true. We're pumping out of the Cumberland River right now on treated water that's been treated by the Davidson County right. into the Cumberland that we're pumping back down here, treated to coming back down here.
But the Cumberland is different from
right.
the Cumberland's
a bit different. Cumberland's
got a dilution rate.
If you want water that hasn't been through a water treatment plant, you better drink Coors.
Waste. That's it.
Well, but think about there are really no municipalities that are pumping into the Harpeth south of us.
Keep going.
Now let's go on.
So the next thing we'll talk a little bit about is some of the upcoming regulatory requirements, and this does have a driver in some of the decisions that you'll be making over the next couple months as well. The first thing we'll talk a little bit about that I think we've mentioned previously is the long-term two enhanced surface water treatment rule. This applies to any municipality, utility, et cetera, that treats a surface water, which in your case you do from the Harpeth River. Each of those sources was required to take sampling to look for cryptosporidium, which is can cause sickness, cause the problems up in Minneapolis, I don't know, 10, 15 years ago.
Milwaukee.
I was called, had the MI right, so. So this required that each system do an analysis of that. Well, when the city did the analysis and the sampling within the Harpeth, they did have one hit of cryptosporidium. What that does is, from an EPA standpoint, that puts you in a different level, what they term as bins. When CTE did the original classification, this was in the original study, that was before this was done. So the assumption was that the plant would fall into that bin one category with no cryptosporidium hits. There actually was one cryptosporidium hit, which puts you in bin two, which does force you into another, what EPA terms is their LT2 toolbox. So there's a couple of different things that you can do to meet that requirement. One would be changing some of the operational management practices. What, in general, the key pieces of that are, is it sort of limits your filtration runs and your filtration, how they're usually monitored in NTUs or turbidity units. It limits what the range you can work within that is set out in the Clean Water in the Drinking Water Act now. So it makes the operational side of and management of the plant much more difficult to do from an operation standpoint, much more expensive. Have to backwash your filters many more times than you would now. The other two options are to have UV disinfection on your effluent. A little bit different than the UV disinfection you have at the wastewater plant in the water system. Correct me if I'm wrong, primarily it's an in-pipe. It's an in-pipe unit because there's much less, because the water's already a lot cleaner, the costs of that are a lot less than they are in a wastewater treatment plant side, and we'll talk about that a little bit in a second. The other third option is to go to membrane filtration, which just puts you at a much higher level of pore size, so you're removing a lot more. Your log removals are a lot higher of that cryptosporidium, and so that's where that side comes from. The other key regulatory requirement that's quickly coming. By the way, that LT2 requirement for the city falls in October of 2012, so basically a little over a year from now. In much the same way. The DBP, disinfection byproduct rule, is something that you are already acting under through the IDSC program for EPA. Many of you may know that over the last couple of quarters, there have been what the way that is monitored now is an average of your four sites that you're mandated to monitor at. So currently, you take all four of those sites, you take the average, and if you're over that limit, then that is considered a violation. Starting in October of next year, it goes to site-specific yearly running averages. So each location itself will be a compliance point, and that will be a running average. So locations that are already known to be problem areas now, instead of being able to buffer those with a couple of the others that may not be as much of a problem set, then you're going to have to average that one location itself. And so, and that's for your THMs, which have to be less than 80 micrograms per liter, and HAAs, which have to be less than 60 micrograms per liter. I think last month the HAA was at 62. So, you know, you can see that it's really close, but these are tied to some water ages that we'll discuss later on with the distribution system.
So you're talking about these two specifically that are monitored?
That's correct. All the DVPs are tied back to these two specific compounds.
Yeah, it's two groups of compounds, halocetic acids and total trihalomethanes.
And this is something a lot of communities and utilities throughout the state and the country are struggling with right now. You know, it's especially for bigger cities where they have multiple locations. The amount of monitoring locations is based on your size of your system and the amount of customers you have. So these bigger systems are able to buffer some of their bad locations because they have more sites, or even, you know, have a lot of concern with a lot of this when it gets to single site locations as it goes into the future.
And I think it's worth just mentioning quickly for folks who don't understand why these show up in your distribution system, but when you have source water that has organic carbon in it, and it could be naturally occurring, and you add chlorine to that water for disinfection, then these disinfection byproducts form. And the reason that they're a concern is at very, very low concentrations, there is a human health risk for cancer. So that's why these are regulated at these very low levels.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned increased population or users?
The more customers you have, it puts you in a different bracket.
Increase the need for more sites. So
right.
Have we gone from, how do we get to four? Have we always been four?
Yes. And so that all goes back to your original classification back in the original, what's called the initial distribution system evaluation, the IDSE report that was filed by the city back in probably 2006, 2007, somewhere around that range it was due. At that point, your size is set based on these.
So is the solution to remove more of the organics?
Well, it's
within the treatment.
We'll talk a little bit when we get to the distribution system, but there's two general practices. You can try to remove more of the organics at your treatment plant, so lessen your ability to create these DVPs, or you can also, these things happen over time, you can also then try to address your water age within your system. That's been shown to have a pretty direct correlation. The older your water in your system, the more time these DVPs have to form as the chlorine is in contact with them, etc. So we'll touch a little bit on both of them, but and I think that's a good question, Mike, because that really ties back into the discussion that I mentioned earlier, that to always keep in mind at the time you may have problems with these, a lot of your water is coming from Harpeth Valley and only a small portion is coming from your own treatment. So it's sort of a balance of, you may be able to spend a lot of money at the treatment plant, really get down your DVP potential at the treatment plant to almost nothing, and if it's still the water age is high enough coming from Harpeth Valley, you still potentially could have some issues. And so it's a balance of those two pieces.
And Mark Hilde and I had the opportunity to meet with Harpeth Valley folks this morning and went over some various issues, things they're doing. They're very much aware of these same issues throughout all the communities they serve and are working through a lot of the same things in terms of what they're doing with their treatment processes and how they're working it too. So not only is the city of Franklin, but our provider we purchase from is also aware of working on some of these same issues.
And just for y'all's knowledge as well, the state of Tennessee has actually been pretty proactive with wholesalers, suppliers to other utilities in the way the regs are wrote. Basically, at the connection point, they are required to be no higher than 60% of the limit as it comes into your system, or else basically if there were to be a violation, the state looks at it as both entities are, you know, ultimately responsible for that and must work together to figure out how that's to be resolved. A lot of states don't necessarily have that, so there's a lot of places where their wholesalers may not be providing them as high quality water, and there's really not a lot they can do about it besides try to do something on their end. So the third thing, and I'm sure none of y'all have heard anything about this over the last last 2 weeks, and that's obviously one of the reasons we added this in, but taste and odor are secondary drinking limits. They're not primary drinking standards. The things that happen with taste and odor primarily have no health risk at all. They just are much easier to detect by the human than anything that may be these micro constituents or anything else that's in your water. So the key thing with specifically with geosmin and MIB, which are the two primary odor and taste causing constituents, is they're noticeable at very, very low limits. Mm-hmm. I think Katie said what in general the odor threshold is, but as you see there, 10 for, I guess, geosmin and 29 for MIB. That's parts per trillion. So, I mean, you see you can have very, very, very low amounts of these things in the water, and your normal customer is going to be able to notice that, and it calls, and you know, readily they can tell the difference between their regular everyday water. It is formed by algae in the water, which dies off and then forms these products. It just happens this summer regionally that's been a very big problem. There's multiple things you'll hear throughout the region. I was actually talking to someone from Metro Water Services the other day who works definitely with their treatment plant, their water in their distribution system, and there is a lot of discussion that is tied back, you know, that the water within the Cumberland and a lot of surrounding areas is a lot warmer, the temperature is a lot hotter because the core is keeping these after last summer and the floods, and a lot of the blame that they may have taken one way or the other, right or wrong, for some of the issues with the dam, they're keeping a lot of things lower, and therefore the water temperature itself is a lot warmer when it comes out. There's also, as you're aware, they're doing a lot of repairs specifically at Wolf Creek, where there's a concern that dam may fail at some time. So they're keeping a lot of those dams a lot lower for that reason as well. So we're not, that's truly the cause. That's a lot of what we've heard through the region, but it isn't just a problem that y'all have seen here locally in Franklin. It's something that has been pretty widespread throughout the region. There are, you know, definitive ways to add treatment for some of these. It's primarily an organic problem, either with activated carbon, ozone enhanced biofiltration, or other advanced oxidation, which can remove greater than 99%. Keep that one sort of in mind, because we'll discuss a little bit about that as it pertains to the water treatment plant in just a second. All right. Any questions on any of the regulations? Those are, as we stated, you know, those two being in October next year are things that are pretty tight on the radar as far as looking at ways to get in compliance with those as the regulations continue to increase.
Restate those just specifically one more time.
The first being long-term two, BIN 2 classification, which means by October of next year you must meet one of those BIN 2 classification methods of treatment to meet the requirements. The DBP, the disinfection byproduct rule, which next year, although it's already in place now, it's now currently, as I mentioned, an average across all sites. Next year will go to a running average at each site itself independently. So if you have one site that's traditionally a problem, you literally could potentially be in violation every single month. And then the third is just to talk a little bit about taste and odor. There's no violation obviously associated with that, but obviously, like we mentioned, from a customer standpoint, it's probably one of the more preferable things that they notice. You know, along if you were to have any kind of color or something where it starts coloring people's clothes, that's another thing that people seem to notice a lot. So we'll move on a little bit to the water treatment plant. In our scope on the water treatment plant, obviously we didn't, y'all have done as a board a lot of work over the past 5 or 6 years on looking at the water treatment plant. We didn't want to reinvent the wheel. Basically what we did is go back and look at a lot of the work that CTE had done, bring a lot of these numbers up to date, and then what you'll see at the bottom is we did sort of add in the potential of going to UV disinfection at the water plant, which would meet your BIN 2 classification. You also see that option number three, which CTE was one of the options CTE had previously discussed, would be going to a total membrane plant. Obviously, in that case, you would also be able to meet your Bin 2 classifications. You'll see that associated with the disinfection, we also have an AOP adder, which if you recall back to the taste and odor screen, and you also recall back to the discussion on the possibility of a wastewater treatment plant being upstream. And if you go back to Alderman Berger's question last month about potentially upcoming regulations and how are we planning for that, there is obviously a concern. We actually at the Katie put on a helped put on a workshop at the Water Professionals Conference for Kentucky and Tennessee this year on micro constituents, emerging contaminants. You know, there's a lot of buzzwords associated with this that EPA is currently studying. That would obviously be a concern, would be one of the concerns if you did have, or even if you didn't, just because of source water, as Clyde referred to earlier. But especially with having a wastewater treatment plant just upstream, that would obviously be something you'd want to have the ability to treat for were there to be any rules come about. So the UV would meet your Bin 2 classification, but then the adding of the AOP, which is basically adding a side stream of hydrogen peroxide post-UV, and that creates an advanced oxidation of your water, which would handle, which is one of the preferred ways of handling any of these emerging contaminants. As we just mentioned, it would also have the potential to help with taste, you know, a large scale with the taste and odor problems just at your plant yourself, once again, separating out the two water sources. But one reason we've looked at adding these potentially at either the potential wastewater treatment plant south of town or at the water plant, and because of the quality of the water and the amount of the flow, it's much more cost effective to treat it at the water plant itself. The other key point with this is you can sort of read the breakdown of each of the potential upgrades to 4 million gallons. The key thing to remember is to stay in the water treatment plant business. It's not a zero proposition. Just the age of the plant now, some of the needed upgrades that are there, the addition of the need for UV to meet the Bin 2 classification, it's still a cost, as you see there, of $5.4 million is the estimation of what needs to be done to the plant, even if you want to stay at 2.1 million gallons. So you see the difference is about double between if you stay at the 2.1 MGD capacity as opposed to going to a 4 MGD capacity. These numbers are relatively similar to what you should have seen, you know, for y'all that were on the board when CTE was going through this original report. Like I said, we brought these up to date, reanalyzed some of the stuff, added the potential to meet the Bin 2, but in general, the numbers should be relatively similar to the analysis that was done previously. All right. The other key thing, which we really want to spend some time on tonight, is the water distribution system. Once again, the key being the fact that from a city standpoint, at times, only about 25% of your water is actually treated by out of the Harpeth itself. Everything else is coming into the distribution system through Harpeth Valley and how that affects your system. This drawing here, getting back to, this is out of the city's existing water model. We've updated the water model, ran some additional water quality analysis on it, and have been working with the city staff to look at some options, as we'll discuss in a second, to address some of these. But what you see here in the blue and the red are areas of either medium or high, what we're terming DBP potential. So in other words, going back to that DBP rule we were talking about earlier, these areas that are color-coded here are the areas within your city system that, because of what we do when we look at water models, is we model age. Now, there is always some assumptions. You know, a model is exactly that. It is a model. It's not an exact replica of exactly how it always happens, but it's a very good tool that we utilize all the time, and actually that EPA utilizes to analyze where your problem areas may be. What this shows is there's a lot of areas, particularly in the southern and the eastern part of town, over near the hospital area, and east of there, south going down Lewisburg, Columbia areas, that have, because of the water age that they currently show within the system, have a high potential or a likely potential to have some DBP problems. Primarily, a lot of that, as you see up there, You got a lot of high water age near tanks, near dead ends. That's pretty common. What happens, we'll show you a little bit of what happens in the system because of the Harpeth Valley connection points. You'll see up at the top of the map, the direct north point is one connection to Harpeth Valley along Hillsborough. The other connection is the one green line that sort of goes to the northwest, is out near the Natchez Trace area, which is the other connection to the. So what happens, a lot of the water, as you'll see on the next slide, a lot of the water in the system gets into these tanks, and what happens during, it never gets back out, so it just continues to age. And if at any time when it does get back out, it's an older age water because of the way the system's set up.
Why doesn't it get out?
Oh, we're fixing the shut. Next slide, we'll touch on that a little bit.
One of the issues is that once the water comes into the system on the north side, there's some hydraulic issues with moving that water to the south end of the city in general.
And I would make a key point. If you go back four years from right now, we're all, you know, y'all are all sitting around the table. Many of y'all were dealing with the issue of just coming off the drought, and we needed more quantity. Unfortunately, the city has done an excellent job at meeting the quantity. You have over 11 million gallons of storage within your system. The state only requires one time your treatment capacity, so average day. So you're well above what's needed. You have a lot of, from a pump station standpoint, from an infrastructure standpoint, made a lot of improvement. That from a quantity-based standpoint, your system is very well developed. It's looped around, very well developed from a quantity standpoint. What's happened is now the EPA has come back with these water quality. Forever it was, we need fire flow. We need to make sure we have flow for drought conditions. We need to make sure that when Joe turns his pipe, when turns his faucet at his house, he's going to get some water, and we're servicing him in that way. Unfortunately, now the regulatory atmosphere is going the opposite way, and it's the same thing we're seeing with a lot of systems, is they're having to try to now balance. Where's that line to balance having enough water quantity and the adequate fire flow protection, but also meeting these water quality regulations? Because it was always, before, the water quality was always at the plant. If you get it out of the pipe at the plant and you're meeting your limits, no one cared what it was doing out in the system. Now EPA cares what's happening, and that's where it's driving a lot of these decisions.
And it's just the up-to-date thing, because I now realize a little map that I had that was sent to me in 2007, I now see what the blue and red was. It didn't have any explanations on it, or any explanations I could read, but I know, but this is up-to-date, right?
Yes, ma'am. This is with all the made changes, includes...
Is that Western thing where we added that vault? You know, to improve the distribution from Harpeth Valley?
All the improvements are shown on here. In fact, I think even the improvements that are almost currently complete are included with this map.
Okay.
The key is the next slide, and I won't spend too much time explaining this,
mm-hmm.
but it's what happens is, like Katie said, the pressure coming from Harpeth Valley, as you see on that graph, is right around 900 PSI,
mm-hmm.
I mean 900 feet, excuse me. Their hydraulic grade line is approximately 900 feet. The plant and the tanks within the city are set somewhere between 854 to 860. That matches, without Harpeth Valley's feed, the system floats perfectly with the plant. Everything's on one common grade line. Mm-hmm. It's a great way to operate a system.
Mm-hmm.
You can go to Metro, where they've purchased other systems, et cetera. They have to break their system into many different parts. The problem is, when Harpeth Valley is a constant feed, it's basically like drawing that line all the way across. So that feed is constant all the time into the system. So what happens is these tanks get submerged under that hydraulic grade line.
Mm-hmm.
So water goes in, and unless that line drops down below where those tanks, it never really comes in and out. So the water just continues to age. So we've looked at a couple of different ways and are still currently working with staff on a couple of different ways to address this. What you see here is an updated map with some of these improvements sort of put in there. And as you can see, a huge improvement within the system. There's still some tanks that we're trying to figure out the best way to utilize, potentially look at other ways of utilizing pump station within the system to sort of force some water in places.
Okay, yes, so now tell us what the difference will be between the other one and this one?
We're still working through. The prime thing is that number one thing you see on there is installation of PRVs at the Harper Valley connections. That's a pressure reducing valve. So what that would actually do is knock down the pressure coming into the system. Still have plenty of pressure at your hydrants, plenty of pressure at your customers, but it then lowers that Harper Valley level down to where it would truly operate within your system. That alone makes a huge emphasis within the system. We're also still looking at some ways, like I said, to utilize tanks in a little bit different operational method, potentially using them seasonally, some other things to force that turnover to happen. Looking at booster stations that may alleviate or be able to force some water around, make it move. Obviously tying in some dead end areas where you're looped around so you don't have dead end mains. Particularly in a lot of your older subdivisions, you may have places where the water line just feeds into that subdivision and you get to the end and it just sort of stops. Also looking at potentially a flushing program. I mean, over the last month or so, the staff have been doing that a lot to deal with some of the taste and odor and some of the turnover. But that's a program that you can actually model and utilize to force some of the water around on a temporary basis, on a somewhat regular basis, to then assure that you have low water quality age. So that's a lot of things we're still sort of discussing. This has been an issue that we've really been hitting on over the last month and trying to address. But from a capital perspective, I won't say it's nothing, but it's most of these improvements are fairly low cost. Mm-hmm. But we'll be able to, over the next month or so, be able to come back with you with a more readily defined plan of how we would propose to sort of address some of these.
Are we using all of our storage now? You know, because at one point, even this year, did we have one of them offline?
There is some tanks, and I'll have to defer maybe to Mark a little bit, but there are some tanks that the staff and Russell are keeping at a lower elevation, not filling all the way. Like I said, a lot of the issues when you run the water model and you look at the age, a lot of times it just continues to go up. There's really very little fluctuation in the tanks. So what a lot of these improvements will do will force that tank to continue to turn over.
Right. We actually manually operate the system in many ways, so we get tank turnover. So we don't have water sitting in a reservoir for extended periods of time. So we do that, but it's operationally, it's labor intensive, and looking for alternatives to
much harder
more automatically versus
much harder to control, much harder to know that you're making the progress that you'd hope you were.
And doing this though would aid the smell problem too.
Not
that we have. I mean, it's much better now.
Right.
That
gets back to the issue and I won't speak for Eric or Mark or what discussions may have occurred with Harper Valley in regard to taste and odor at all, but,
it could make a difference, couldn't it?
The water age potentially could have a small relationship to it. In general, though, the taste and odor goes more back to the treatment and the source water. And in times where you're getting a larger portion of your water from Harper Valley, as we mentioned with a couple of other things, you could have treatment at your own plant, and that 2 million gallons you're producing at your own plant, you could eliminate the issue and still possibly see the issue in other areas depending on how Harper Valley's water is coming into the system.
But it has the potential to help that.
Well, the water age won't help it.
Okay.
What will help it is managing the treatment and managing the source water at the plant. The taste and odor is not integrally related with the water age. I mean,
but let me tell you, those places that you were showing as the high water age are the places that had the worst.
The worst.
Absolutely.
Now,
the dead end issue contributes to it.
And that's
which may relate to age, but it's not the age so much as it is the dead end and the lack of flow, is my understanding.
More the ability to move that water that has that taste and odor out of those areas.
Right. What happens, it seems to, it almost concentrates there because there's no way to keep it moving around.
So what are you treating that water plant?
Volume-wise, 2 million, roughly.
And y'all stayed at basically almost full capacity all summer.
Yeah. We've been at full capacity most of the summer. We did take the plant offline to try some various chemical, I guess, different combinations of chemicals to see if we could address taste and odor better. But primarily, we've been online all summer, and the reservoir still.
And really, in my experience in other years, it's been whenever that got kind of low that we had the smell and the taste problem. But this year, we've been pumping all the time, so that made it more difficult. But it's probably the temperature of the water now, right?
It is a very, I mean, Nashville, you go talk to anyone around, everyone's had the
We're
same
all tasting
combo.
Water in different restaurants around, but okay. Certainly Franklin's not.
Right, exactly. I think that's it. I think that's the last slide. So just generally next steps, we're continuing to look at the water demand and how that relates into the whole picture, and that'll be a big part of the analysis on the Stella. Looking at the water treatment plant improvement options, you saw today, distribution improvement options, which we'll come back with more definitive final recommendation on that and a cost of how to be better assured in compliance next October. And I mentioned the dates earlier as we move forward. So,
thank you.
Interesting.
Yes, I will send you all a copy tomorrow.
Thank you.
And these are on the website as we have them.
Okay. But we can send them to you directly.
And this one will be put on the website. The previous ones are on there.
I'll PDF them if that's okay with everybody.
Oh,
that
sure.
Way it makes it a lot smaller.
I like this one better. I can make sense of that one.
And the next water resource meeting is.
The next
September 28th?
Yes, that's tentative. We should finalize that in the next week or so. We want to make sure that we really have everything fully together so that we can really talk through everything with the committee at that time. But that's what we're shooting for.
Okay. Will y'all let us know?
Yes. For sure, by the time we come and talk with you on the 23rd, we definitely will know that for sure.
So all right, moving on.
Thank y'all.
More about water. Thanks, guys. Consideration ordinance 2011-29, an ordinance to amend Title 22, Chapter 18, to establish new water rates and sanitary sewer user rates, establishing a public hearing for August the 23rd, 2011.
Really, we would like to deal with 5, 6, and 7 all together. This is collectively the water budget and water financial plan. It was presented last month to the Budget and Finance Committee, but the committee felt that this is a pretty important matter that we ought to take a little bit of time and share it with the board in the work session. The rate does take three readings. The first reading is on tonight, and we'll set a public hearing for August 23rd related to the rate adjustments in water and sewer. So what I asked Mark to do is give you just sort of a shortened version walkthrough of the elements that were talked about with budget and finance so you get a sense of what we're doing and where we are. And wow.
You're well prepared, Mark. Good thing it's the shortened version.
I had a guy show up at a deposition one time, said he had just a few exhibits.
So Mark, I think, is leaving nothing to chance here, but wanted to share this with you. As we've done the last couple years, we take a multi-year view of the operating costs of the utilities that the city operates. And these are truly separate business units that we operate. We don't use taxpayer dollars to subsidize what they do. The ratepayer funds come in and should support the operation and cost of operations of those utilities. And the element we've added in the last few years is a multi-year financial planning approach so that we look at the costs that are anticipated to run those operations. And what we've paired with that in the last year especially is looking at our rate structure. And then one of the things the board directed us to do last year was to look at making rate increases over a longer period of time, over 5 years, to get where we need to be, but to set those in as manageable a level as we could to lessen the impact on our customers, our citizens. So we're really following through on the direction that was given a year ago to in terms of the rate structure, but wanted to update you on the costs anticipated and the issues facing these utilities. So I'll let Mark hit the highlights and go from there.
Well, good. I know many of you were at the Budget and Finance Committee meeting, I think back in July, and I have essentially the same presentation here. I wanted to kind of start going through it, and if you have any questions, please let me know, and we'll go through it, and I hope this becomes more of a discussion versus me rambling on, but please feel free to stop me. The copies I have here are identical to the budgets that were presented to you previously. If anyone...
Two copies of it.
Okay, so if anyone needs one, so don't worry, they won't go to waste. I have plenty of people who will use them in my department. But if we could go to the next slide, Mary Ann, please. As Eric had mentioned, the water and sanitary sewer funds are, in fact, enterprise funds. And we run those divisions based on the fees that we get from our users and also through development. And again, I'm going to go through this relatively quickly for sake of time. But we started back in 2007 evaluating the costs of our operations and maintenance. We've done this over 2007, 2009, and most recently in 2010. In doing those cost of service analyses, we looked primarily at user rates. We've introduced the concept of rate funded capital, meaning how the department is going to fund replacement or rehabilitation of infrastructure that's been in the ground for a number of years that serves existing customers, an operational reserve, and of course the user fees. We started going to a biennial budget in 2009. Currently we're in the process of looking at our development fees. How do the development fees that we currently charge, are they going to be adequate enough to serve us long term? And also the integrated water resources planning, there's a financial component to that. So all the projects and proposed policy changes and things of that nature are going to be pulled in and looked at on a financial level as well. And then this year in our budget, we are requesting funding to continue on with cost of services. Also this year, inclusive of reclaimed water, which historically we've not looked at. We've had a consistent reclaimed water rate since, I believe it was in the early 90s.
David,
probably 20 years ago. So it's about, I think operationally we've been able to cover costs fairly well. This year we're, with projects coming out and new customers coming online, we think it's a good time to take a look at those rates and see where we need to go. In terms of the budget, the document goes through the revenues, the expenditures on the operations side, as well as operational capital and rate-funded capital, and I'll touch on that shortly, as well as the proposed rate adjustments that are in the financial plan that we have here. And again, this is a six-year financial plan. We opted to go with 2 years of budget, proposed budget, and then projecting out an additional 4 years beyond that. The revenues for both water and sanitary sewer have declined. It's been declining since 2005 for water through 2010, and 2008 through 2010 for sanitary sewer. There's a number of variables that drive, the revenues that we get, and it's consumption, which is going to be based on weather. It's going to be based on people's economic position. There's a wide array of different variables. We've looked at rate adjustments, as we all know, and I know that's a challenging thing to do. But our rate adjustments we're proposing, we are endeavoring to cover the cost of our operations and maintenance based on the programs that we set forth throughout the past several years. Can we go to the next slide, please? This is an example of the decline of revenues, and this is the water side, just again an example. As you see from 2005, we have had a significant decrease in sales. You recall 2007 was the big drought year, had to go on restrictions. 2008, I think we're still looking at people in a conservation mode. 2009, we had it was actually a very wet summer, so the consumption values that we usually would typically see in the summertime were not there. And again, these are just one of the many factors that drive consumption. And then 2010, we saw a pretty dramatic decrease in sales and volume. This last year, the fiscal year 2011 numbers, we actually did see some recovery, as you can see, and that's that first blue line on the left graph.
The economy drove people to buy less water?
Pardon me?
Are you saying, is it principally landscaping?
I think primarily a lot of it is irrigation.
Yeah, back whenever we were running before and they were saying they had $300 water bills, that got a lot of people's attention.
The average consumption did go down considerably over the past several years. So, and then this past year, we saw an increase in sales. It was about a 10% increase in sales this past year.
Over 2010?
Right, from 2010. Well, the fiscal year 2011, we saw.
But it was a dry year.
It was...
in the summer. After the flood, it was dry.
It was other than the flood.
I said, yeah, after the flood.
Yes, if we could have...
Once we got through that.
If we could have distributed that over a few months.
We need to engineer against all 500-year events.
We all will live through this, one of them.
This budget would look very different if that were the case. I will stay the course. The next slide, the water and sanitary sewer expenditures, we've presented to you the numbers from 2009 through the budget of 2011. You'll note that in the operations side under under water, you'll see in 2010, it's a fairly significant increase, or fairly significantly higher number than the other numbers you'll see in operations. That's an anomaly based on the ARRA funds that we had received and actually had spent that sum of money. So that's explained in the narrative there.
The biggest portion being the reservoir.
Reservoir project. Yes. The next slide is a couple of graphs that depict kind of where the money goes, depending on whether it's operations or debt service or our utilities, the water that we buy from Harpeth Valley. And these are the water and the wastewater sections, respectively. And moving along, and please, again, stop me if anyone would like to discuss anything. The capital expenditures in the operations budget, we view capital expenditures differently depending on the type of item that we're purchasing. We're referring to operations capital as typically equipment and vehicles. It's stuff, the stuff that we need to do and go out and perform maintenance or work on the system. So it's the service trucks, it's the backhoes and that type of item. Those types of items. The rate funded capital is referring to infrastructure replacement and rehabilitation of the existing infrastructure. It's not the expansion of the system. It's replacement of pipes that have been in the ground for some period of time and are no longer functioning or serving. They've outlived their useful life. So that's that replacement cost of the infrastructure.
It just occurred to me, where is your expansion?
Capital expansion. We're going to start presenting that information based on the impact fee analysis that's currently going on. So we're taking a look solely at the operations.
Just because really these are not
yes,
only
ma'am.
Capital expenditures.
Correct. It is inclusive of the rate funded capital as well, though.
But not
the expansion.
Not the expansion.
Yes, ma'am. Yep. The next slide presents kind of a cost breakdown of our operations capital expenditures per division, and we have seven divisions in the water department. And this is the vehicles and the equipment, and you can see over the through 2000.
How the hell you get a machine to write this little? I cannot see this.
They just printed that little.
I'm sorry for the small print.
Too much on one page. I think it's fine.
Thank you. Which
land would you like to be waiting for? What are these here?
Keep moving.
Is he the youngest?
Yes.
All right, so we go to the next slide, please. This is This is also small print.
Thank you.
You're welcome, sir. I'm trying to save paper. These are some examples of rate-funded capital projects that we're looking at. Again, this is rehab or replacement of existing infrastructure. We spent time going through the list of projects with the different staff members, the people who see the infrastructure in the field daily, who work with it. And this is just a small example of what we have to look forward to. We have projects, the numbers exceed 100 in both water and wastewater. So we're looking at prioritizing these projects over some period of time, whether it's 10 or 20 years. And you start getting out beyond 5 to 10 years, and that schedule becomes useless because things change so dramatically over time.
So Mark, all these are proposed new projects.
These are
not projects
underway.
That,
no, these okay. are projects that are we've not started yet. And let me double check on that. That's not 100% accurate. There's a West Main Street water line.
I was going to say, I thought I recognized.
Yes, ma'am. We started looking at the design of that right now, and that's one of the there's infrastructure that's in excess of 90 years old that's in service that needs to be addressed. And
this is a sample of some of those. You've got an older existing system that you're going to have to invest in to maintain service and to keep up with things. And Mark's just providing you with a sampling of some of those. And
right.
That's a component to be built into your financial plan is taking care of existing infrastructure through the rate funded capital.
These are the cost of service curves that they may look familiar to you from the Jackson Thornton study that was performed last year. The top left is the cost of service curve for water residential inside, and the lower right is the cost of service curve for wastewater residential inside. The blue line represents the cost of service, and the axes are dollars per thousand gallon on the left, the vertical axis, and then the horizontal axis is the volume of water in thousands of gallons. So I just want to make sure
because we're
good on
before.
That. So the blue line again is the cost of service. The red line was our curve based on the rates prior to the last rate increase. Again, this was the study that was performed last year, and the green line is actually the current rate that we're working under right now. And I'm going to go on to the next slide and then we'll come back to this slide here. But consistent, as Eric had discussed, consistent with the approach that we had developed last year, we were looking at a five-year period in which we would perform rate adjustments to meet the cost of service. As you go back to those cost curves there, that lower, or the far left portion of that graph is that 1,000-gallon consumption. That's currently what our minimum bill is. And that's where you see the largest discrepancy. It's the blue line relative to the green line. So that's where we fall short the most. So going back to the next slide, that's where we propose to target the rate adjustment. There's a couple things that happen here. We approach the cost of service more closely, and it also reduces the fluctuation in revenues. When you look at that minimum charge, or that charge, you meet that cost of service, that fluctuation in revenue based on consumption decreases. So you're not, if you generally consume 7,000 gallons in a year and you now consume 4,000 gallons, or excuse me, in a month, and you now consume 4,000 gallons in a month, you have that 3,000 gallon, revenue discrepancy. So if you try to achieve that cost of service on that low end, you reduce that fluctuation in revenue. So that's one of the reasons why we're looking at that. The next two slides present what the proposed rate adjustments are for water and wastewater, respectively. These adjustments are identical to the ones that we went through last year.
Well, the increases are identical.
Yes, ma'am.
Not the rates.
The increase, my apologies. Yeah. Yep.
In other words, there will be an increase just the way there was last year.
Yes, ma'am.
Your water rate will not be the same.
Correct. The residential inside, yes, I'm sorry for misspeak. The residential inside rate, we're proposing to increase the, is on the first of the two slides there, $1.60 across the board. And then the sanitary sewer, there's several different, it depends on what rate classification you're in. And I think that's the slide that's currently up on the wall right there. In as you digest that, the next two slides show a rate comparison of the city of Franklin relative to other utilities in Middle Tennessee. As you can see, we remain competitive in terms of our proposed rates. This is the sanitary sewer slide, one that's up here now. So, I mean,
we remain really at or below the average for either the availability component or a typical usage in a month, which is 6,000 to 7,000 gallons.
Right.
So that's what we try to look at. Where are we not only in meeting our costs, but how do we compare to other utilities, other providers in the region? And so this shows us within where that average is, below most, but within that average, a little bit below average, actually.
We assume that they're also increasing their rates periodically?
I don't know that they are they?
I don't want to speculate as to what they're doing, but
the cost of services.
I do know that, like us, they're obligated to meet their cost of service. So,
and they're facing a lot of the same updates and upgrades and regulatory standards that we're facing that we talked about in the previous presentation. Mm-hmm. So we're all kind of working through the same various issues, but some systems are older than others and have some additional requirements that you're going to have to work through.
We're an older system. We would be older than Brentwood.
Mm. Yes,
I would say generally speaking.
And Brentwood doesn't treat water or treat wastewater. So they are really dealing with a distribution system, not the actual provision of water and wastewater services.
Mark,
yes.
You may have already touched on this and I missed it, or you may be going to touch on it. But we talked about adding 4% a year.
Yes, ma'am.
For 5 years.
For water. Yes, ma'am.
For water. All right. With that 4%, will we be able to catch up to our deficit in 5 years? And will we need to do any more updates without adding to that deficit?
Right. Well, when we stepped into the
first of all, we don't have a deficit.
That's right.
We're
right.
meeting our cost
of
obligations.
Service.
We
cost
don't have
right.
a deficit. These well, supports this these
we
funds support themselves.
We are we are primarily not funding some of the rate funded capital projects that need to be.
Isn't that what a deficit is when you?
No.
Okay. We're not.
We are paying our bills.
Money,
we are not in a deficit position as a fund. You may have additional things we need to do, but we are not in a deficit.
I think these
but
rated,
we're behind.
If we were to spend the money on the rate-funded capital projects that need to happen every year from essentially now till the system is no longer, if we were to fund those with the money we have available to us now, we would not have enough money to fund them. That's why we're stepping through the
And that's why we look at the multiple years and you look at the obligations that are coming your way and the cost that it takes to run the utility. But that's different than not bringing in as much as you are spending,
right.
which we are in balance, but we are looking at the needs long term,
right.
and that's where the rates and the costs both on the capital and operating side come together, and that's
so
what
the 4% per year will take care of that, you think?
That's where we are right now, yes. And Alderman Peterson brought up a good point. Last year we had a pretty significant increase in consumption. I think it was roughly 10%, which resulted in an increase in revenues. So she had brought that up during the last meeting. When you again look at consumption values on water and then the service value, I don't want to call it consumption on wastewater because that sounds interesting, but
the use.
What's a ute?
That's a different
thing. Don't go there. know that.
You can only talk to me about water and wastewater.
For so long,
we lost it.
Yeah, we're at the end. We're coming up on the hour and a half.
Yes, sir. I'm pressing on. Again, those values fluctuate. And in any given year, you can see a high consumption level. You can see relatively low consumption levels, again, dependent on economic drivers. You dependent on weather and a number of other things. And we certainly don't want to be in the position in which we are overcharging customers. That's not where we're headed with this incremental increase over the period of 5 years. What we do wish to do, though, and again proposed in this budget, is to take another look at our cost of service. And you know, it's a relatively low cost evaluation to make sure we're still going in the right direction, to still make sure that we are going to achieve what that cost of service is with our revenues, and then make those rate adjustments appropriately. And not, we don't want to exceed it beyond, but you know, we need to continuously look at these rates. And after our five-year plan, we will continue to look at rates because they cannot remain stagnant. I mean, things change considerably, whether it's the regulatory environment, financial drivers, fuel, energy, any number of things can drive the cost of a budget, so, or the magnitude of a budget. So
what we've tried to do is be as manageable as we can, regular and manageable rate adjustments, as opposed to waiting a period of time and then having to make very large rate adjustments. So we're trying to manage it over a longer period of time and make it as manageable as we can to the consumer.
But we're actually building up some money so that we can do needed rehabilitation, if you want to say that.
Yeah, we're looking at budgeting a sum of money to set aside, whether we spend it all in that 1 year or not. Some of these projects are going to be beyond the amount of money we save in that 1 year. Some are going to be less, and you know that number is going to fluctuate depending on the priority of projects. So I think that's the.
I think there's a quick thing on reclaim.
Oh yes, my apologies.
There is a rate adjustment proposed for that.
Again, our reclaim system has been in the ground for 20 years. The rate of reclaimed water has been 87 cents a thousand gallons per thousand gallons the entire time. As I had mentioned earlier, we are looking at additional customers. We're looking at more intensive, though not to the magnitude of the water system, operations and maintenance of that system. And this, you'll see in the budget, you know, in the proposed FY 2014, we start looking at the point in which our revenues, based on projections, will not meet what our expenditures are. So we're proposing to incorporate reclaimed water in the cost of service analysis this year, and to, I guess, head in the direction we need to go in, are proposing a 10 cent per thousand gallon increase to bring it 97 cents per thousand gallons. That was a long-winded way of saying
we need to increase that price.
So.
Great job.
Thank you. And then this last slide here is just some of the monies we had received through the ARRA projects for 2010 and 2011. We're actually investigating a couple of other ARRA possibilities right now, so we'll keep you posted on that as time comes. So.
After all that, I hate to ask
sure.
the question. But, and this is not a part of what the proposal is, but I noticed as a part of this, the water service reconnect service charge. It's mm-hmm. on page 2 just of the ordinance itself under item 5. And it says $35 normal business hours. This is the reconnect service on water. And then it says $75 non-business hours, holidays and weekends. And my question is, do we receive the payment on holidays and weekends and then send someone out to reconnect? I mean, who's here to receive it?
I'll have to talk with utility billing on the details of that.
I just wanted to bring it up.
Yeah.
And
nothing, a very minor consideration.
And I don't know that that's not, is that a change or that's just
no, it's not
restating
a
what's already
but,
there?
I mean, I'm asking.
It's restated. Yeah, I don't know how often that
I do
happens.
Know part of the answer, but I want to.
Okay. Yeah, part of it is we actually have different service hours.
I understand that. But that's not holidays and weekends,
correct.
I don't think. And
you're right.
But we might want to talk about that on the service
sure.
hours, too.
Okay, number eight, consideration resolution 2011-37, authorizing the City of Franklin's joint participation with Williamson County regarding joint bids on delinquent tax items.
Sounds good.
This really has us working together to collect the delinquent taxes.
Move on.
Everybody good with that?
Nice job, Kristen.
I think we'll move on after that.
You got that done.
Consideration resolution 2011-38, a resolution authorizing City of Franklin, Tennessee to participate in the TML Risk Management Pool Safety Partners Loss Control Matching Grant Program.
We may be able to do this one just as quick.
Safety shoes.
The money comes to us for safety, for boots, basically, and we've been doing this program for several years, but they require a resolution.
Next is number 10, consideration of City of Franklin Contract 2011-0110, a grant agreement from National Park Service for battlefield acquisition Loring's Advanced Tract.
Just pass through.
This is a pass through. You approved this a couple months ago, but this is the specific agreement, so.
You can really talk fast, Catherine.
You're coming up here anyway, Catherine.
Oh, I'm sorry. Question, Alderman Berger.
It says that, okay, I understand what we're doing here, but it says that that we act as the pass-through for that, and that we are bound by the acceptance of the grant, by all the terms and conditions therefore set forth by the United States Department of Interior. How does this tie our hands as a city government as far as this property in the future?
In terms of just acting as the pass-through, if they can't meet, if the Civil War Preservation Trust can't meet these terms, then they don't go ahead and purchase the property. So we are not really on the line. It's really them on the line. Once they get the property purchased, you know, that this is for the sale of property.
They own it.
They own it.
And they have the responsibility.
Okay, yes. Even though we act as pass-through, they will legally outright own it. We will be out of the picture. Mm-hmm. And anything they do with it, any maintenance or any future, or if they default on it, it still belongs to them, doesn't come back to the city.
That's correct.
Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
This is pretty much boilerplate. This is
I just want to make
always.
Sure,
yes.
Because boilerplate is not always...
They are the owner.
Not always.
And they
we've approved these numerous times.
Yes.
They require that they have a local government pass through. They can't do it themselves.
Pass through, but I just want to make sure that we weren't obligated in any way, shape, or form afterwards on it.
Once we buy it, it's theirs. Once they buy it, it's theirs. That's their obligation.
I assume that, but I didn't ask.
Number 11, consideration of City of Franklin Contract 2011-0111, an interlocal agreement between the City of Franklin, Tennessee and Williamson County, Tennessee concerning performance surety.
And basically what this is that the county has been doing the improvements that they have indicated they would do as part of their site plan or their plats. This codifies that into an agreement that both the county and ourselves can agree with. This does not cover the school district. This is Williamson County and Williamson County projects.
So they don't have to post bonds or anything?
Mm-hmm. No. They agree to basically the standards.
They do.
Number 12, consideration inter-planning commission review of a preliminary plat for Watkins Creek subdivision section 5 containing 5 lots on 41.85 acres located off North Chapel Road.
No.
It's a courtesy.
No problem.
This is a courtesy?
It's a courtesy.
I was going to say, I went to that meeting, actually, even though it's in the county, and that's good because that's a subdivision that's not been completed and someone's coming in to complete it.
Yes.
Which is...
Good thing. And it's small. 5 lots is a small subdivision.
And then maybe doing some more later, but that's...
Yeah. Number 13, consideration program year 2011-12, emergency shelter grant contract with Tennessee Housing Development Agency. Any questions about that one?
We do. This is something we hear.
Okay, we'll adjourn and reconvene at 7 p.m.
All right.